जय नारायण. डियर स्टूडेंट्स, आई होप यू ऑल आर फाइन. स्टे होम, स्टे सेफ. एज द प्रोसेस ऑफ अनलॉक 3 इज ऑन, सो आई होप यू ऑल माइट बी हैविंग योर बुक्स नाउ विद यू. बट ऑलवेज रिमेंबर टू फॉलो SMS. इफ यू आर गोइंग आउट ऑफ योर हाउस, कीप सैनिटाइजर्स विद यू. Whenever you touch anything outside, please apply sanitizer. Wear mask while moving out of your house. When you return back home, then also apply soap and wash your hands properly. And the third thing, when you are there in the market or out of your house, maintain social distancing. Whenever you return back, please ask your parents to provide you a glass of hot water with a lemon added to it, because it's going to help you fight with the virus and bacteria. So now, dear students, let's start with our studies. So today we'll start a new poem, poem 2, an elementary school classroom in a slum, which is written by Stephen Spender. Before starting the poem, we need to know about the poet. So, Stephen Spender was an English poet and essayist. He left University College, Oxford, without taking a degree, and then went to Berlin in 1930. Spender, he took a very keen interest in politics and declared himself to be a socialist and pacifist. Books of Spender, they include poems of dedication, The Edge of Being, The Creative Element. In the poem, An Elementary School Classroom in a Slum, here Spender, he has concentrated on theme of social injustice and class inequalities. So, we can say so that Stephen, he was an English poet, novelist, essayist who concentrated on theme of social injustice and the class struggle. Now, he was appointed the 17th Poet Laureate Consultant in Poetry to the United States Library of Congress in 1963. Before starting the poem, you need to know what is there in the poem. So here, a school is being described. The school is in a slum, in the very dirtiest surrounding, where the sky, it always looked smoky and dark. It is a school in which all the children, they are ill-fed, ill-nourished, emaciated, and they are very unhappy with the situation in which they live. The school has sour cream walls. Its walls are decorated with some donated paintings, maps, etc. And all these things are meaningless for these children. It is a dark place. And unless these catacombs, like hive, they receive sunshine and open air, no education can take place in this school. Before starting the explanation of the poem, I'd like to tell you about the theme of this poem. So, an elementary school classroom in a slum, it deals with the social injustice and class inequalities, and it attacks on the capitalistic economies in which the rich, they are becoming richer, and
even as more and more problems and miseries, they mire the lives of the poor. They are devoid of any opportunity and have become prey to social injustice. In this poem, Spender he demands equal opportunities for education for the poor and the underprivileged. Now comes the stanza one. It is here in front of you. So, here the poet describes the very pathetic condition of children in a slum school. The children studying in the class are far away from a world abounding in nature's bounties and the brighter aspects of life. Their world is full of extreme poverty and harsh realities. Unlike other school children, who are usually energetic and lively, these children, they appear lifeless and withered. These children, they look pathetic. They have pale faces and their hair is unkempt, falling all over their faces, making them look like rootless weeds. So here, in the first line, in the classroom, the poet is telling that there is a tall girl sitting who has put her head down. Why she has put her head down? Because possibly she is very depressed, maybe due to extreme poverty or because of some family problem. Or we can guess that possibly she was depressed because of physical and mental exhaustion. The poet is describing a second boy. The boy who is sitting in the corner is also very thin, almost like a paper. Undoubtedly, he is thin like a paper due to malnutrition. He has a very big bulging eyes like those of a rat. This suggests his timid nature and search for food and security. Now, the third boy is being described. The boy sitting is the heir of his father's twisted disease. He has stunted growth and is sitting at his desk with his twisted bone. You can say that he was the living example of his father's bone disease. He was not having any enthusiasm in him. So, in the last lines, the poet is telling about a very sweet character. There was a boy in the classroom. He was a very sweet-natured boy. And he was sitting at the back of the classroom. And possibly he was dreaming. That's the reason why the poet is telling that he was a sweet-natured boy. What was he dreaming? He was dreaming of squirrels playing games on trees. He would have preferred to be out of his classroom in the open and play like squirrels. This speaks of the dull and monotonous atmosphere in the classroom which fails to attract him. Now, this is stanza 2 in front of you. Here, the walls of the classroom are being described. The walls, they appear to be very pale and dirty. Sour cream walls, it means they are very pale and dirty. And they give a very unpleasant feeling. Now, the poet is telling that on these walls, many donated items, they have been put up. These represent the world of the rich and prosperous. The things which were being donated, they represent the world of rich and prosperous, not the world of the people of slum. There is a picture of Shakespeare on the wall. The picture of dome of big cities represents the quality of life in those cities. The early morning sky is also shown as cloudless in another picture. Now, there is also a picture of the beautiful Tralee Valley. a region in the Austrian Alpine province, which is being covered with flowers. The world map, which has divided the world into countries, big and small, symbolically shows the whole world to the children. But all these pictures, they have no meaning to these impoverished children. The world depicted on these walls is not the world of these children. Their world does not contain huge dome or prosperity or the beauty presented in the picture. Unfortunately, their world is painted with fog, the fog of hopelessness, the fog of hunger. Their future is grim and uncertain and sealed with a dark and dull sky. Once again, the poet is saying that their world is far away from the actual world of rivers and capes. Now, this is the third paragraph in front of you. Here, the poet now calls the portrait of Shakespeare wicked because it is meaningless for children going to a slum school. Why meaningless? Because there is no quality education in these schools. The children here will never ever learn about Shakespeare's work. Now, the poet is telling that map is also a bad example for them because for these children, their classroom is the whole world. There is no world for them beyond their poverty, beyond their hunger and hopelessness. So, these maps are unreal for these children. The beautiful world with its offering like the sun, love, care, ships, they all tempt them. They have no other work simply to attract them to steal because they cannot have all these worldly things. They live in cramped holes like hutments and there is no end to their miseries. There is an unending state of gloom, hunger and despair. Now here, the poet is telling in the last four lines that their bodies, they look like garbage heaps. They are very skinny and their bones are peeping out of their skin. The state of poverty is intensified by the fact that the glasses which they are wearing, they were also cracked and mended. All of their life is being destroyed here in the slum. The slum is like a blot as big as doom on the maps of these children. Now here, the poet is telling that these children, they'll continue to suffer the hell unless the governors, unless the inspectors or the visitors, they come forward to help them. Here, the poet is now wanting the civilized world to act as a bridge between them and the world of these children. They should offer these children a glimpse of a better world so that the maps become their window to the beautiful and charming world outside. Then, these windows of the elementary school classrooms, which confine all their hopes and dreams, must also be broken so that these children, they could also come out in the green fields away from that filthy environment or surrounding. Now, in the last line, the poet is desiring that these children, they should be allowed to run free on the golden sand under a clear sky. That is, they should also be allowed to make progress. They should be allowed to have quality education. The poet here feels that education can help them immensely because according to him, history is written by those whose language has the warmth and energy of the sun.
So, dear children, that was the explanation of the chapter. Now, let me tell you in a nutshell about the chapter. So, the poet looks at these school children. There is no zeal or zest on their face. They look useless and meaningless altogether, discarded and totally neglected. Their pale faces are covered with disheveled and uncombed hair. A very thin, tall girl, must be over age two, is unable to hold her head up. It shows lack of strength and energy. One more boy in the class is paper thin and his eyes is roving like a rat's eye. One more boy, undergrown boy, who had inherited the disease of bone from his father, was in that class, and that boy was at his desk reciting the lesson. The boy on the back seat was looking like an exception in the classroom. He looks calm, happy, and cheerful. His mind is full of the game he had watched as the squirrels play in the hollow of the tree. The classroom walls is being described in the next, that they were being pale and dirty. The bust of Shakespeare, an open map of the world, and a few more pictures of some extremely beautiful places, they hung from the walls, and all these things, they were received as donation, but they were useless and meaningless for all these children. Now, the world that has been drawn in this picture, in those pictures, they were not the children's world. Clearly, there were two distinct worlds. One is the world of want, the world of hunger, poverty, and diseases. And that is the children's world. The other is the beautiful, luxurious world of the rich and the powerful, which was shown in the pictures. Slum children's world has no hope or happiness. It is very dark and bleak. The smoke and poisonous vapors, they make the air very dingy and dangerous even during the day atmosphere. Shakespeare is meaningless for these children. Beautiful places shown in the picture evokes no memories within these children. They cannot identify with these rich and prosperous places, so they are tempted to steal. These children are useless and worthless, like slag heaps. They are so thin that their bones are visible through the clothes. Some of them, they even wear spectacles, and that also, that are mended. They look very unsuitable and ill-fitting. In order to make this school real and good, everyone, the governor, the inspector, the visitor, or parents, all the people, they will have to make a joint effort. Only the joint effort of all can break open these underground graves and stir the dead spirits. Once these dark dungeons are broken open, children will come out to the stand and under the shining and clear sky. They will gain the ease and the facilities to read and learn and get educated. Because history is always made or enacted by those who are really enlightened and educated. That's all, dear children. I hope. So, dear students, that's all in this lecture. We'll meet once again with the fresh thoughts in new lecture. Till then, Jai Narayan, all of you.